And this Breaking India started, you know, it talks about various historical fault lines that have been made up. Either they've been just created, like the Aryan-Dravidian divide that really wasn't there, or they have taken they've taken something that did exist, like Jati fault lines that turned into caste under the British. You know, there's a nice books already on how Jati became caste. And these fault lines are being exacerbated, they've been being exploited. So either they didn't exist, they're new, or they existed, but they were not that bad. And so I've been studying these to see who controls the discourse, why they control it, who funds it, and you know, what's the consequence, what's the harm being produced, is there any counter discourse, and if not, why not? That's kind of what I've been looking at. And my foundation also sponsored a lot of work on the history of ancient India. We plan on producing 20 volumes on history of Indian science and technology, of which 9 are done. And so it's a 20-volume series, each being done by a prominent academic scholar somewhere, metallurgy or city building or architecture. And in that context, we started looking at this whole Aryan debate also, and found that actually the evidence is against all that, all those old theories. And so the idea of Dravidian is something that people haven't studied enough. Those who are critical of Aryan theory criticize the Aryan issue, but not so much the Dravidian issue. Now it turns out that the real problem on the ground is the Dravidian identity, because that's a real politically live identity in South India. And a whole lot of our textbooks and a whole lot of discourse is based on that assumption. And the two are mirror images. If one exists, the other exists. If one is thrown out, the other will be thrown out. I mean, there can't be Dravidians unless there are also Aryans. And there can't be Aryans unless there are also Dravidians. So to refute and debunk one is not good enough. You've got to debunk both of them. And you cannot say, okay, we don't want this idea of Aryans to be in the discourse, but we continue having the idea of Dravidians. Because as long as you have the idea of Dravidians, by it's implicitly the case that you are assuming Aryans also. So this book, we focus on the Dravidian side of that binary. And we look at the history of how the Dravidian came about, Aryan, Dravidian, both of them, how they came about, and what were the forces, and what are the forces today that are keeping this alive. But what galvanized this project, gave it a kind of sense of concern and urgency, was a very chance meeting I had in Princeton with some scholar who had just come back from India. And in casual conversation over lunch, he said, I was there for the Afro-Dalit project. So I said, what is this Afro-Dalit project? I never heard of such a thing. So he said, oh, it's a project that you must know about. I said, no, I never. He said, it's a project of, you know, the Dalit history, that they're the blacks of India, and the non-Dalits are the whites of India. And so the history of American slavery, black-white race relations, can be used as a frame, as a paradigm, to interpret the history of Dalits as exploited people in India from exploited by other Indians. I thought this was very silly. Maybe nobody would be doing all this, you know. But I wanted to verify, so I got some references from him, who was behind it, who's sponsoring it. And I found there's a huge amount of activity going on to promote these kind of ideas. And the cover on the book, I found this on his wall. He had a map of India, balkanized. There's Mughalistan, Dravidistan, Dalitistan, and so on. Then I discovered there's a site called Dalitistan.org. I went there and they had all these theories about, you know, the Dalits being Africans, being exploited and made slaves by non-Dalits in India, this sort of thing, very common. And how speakers are coming from the West to conduct workshops with youths in rural areas, and so etc. And I found that the church was involved in this. A lot of Western church involved in this sort of thing. Then this led me to discover more about the Joshua Project, which is based in Denver, where they are doing a micro level study of every district in India, every district in the world for that matter. in order to create a marketing plan based on the ethnic, caste, and socioeconomic demographics of each and every state as a marketplace for conversion purposes. I came across something called the Dalit Freedom Network in Denver, and it was widely quoted by the Indian press, the Dalit Freedom Network, as though they are the voice of Dalits. But when I did my research, I found that the principals running it, the founders and trustees, not one of them is a Dalit. They're all white Christians. So many of them kind of very right-wing. So right-wing and hardly known for their human rights championing in their home country, a lot of bias in their positions, happened to be concerned about the emancipation of Dalits in the other end of the world. Very strange. I thought, why would they be doing all this? And they have a few poster boys who are Dalits to put up as the faces. So Kanchan Elaya, who writes this book, you know, Why I'm Not a Hindu, or another book he wrote, Post-Hindu India, just came out. Some ministers released it. He got awards for it, being invited to university to give talks. And someone like Dinesh D'Souza, these kind of people are their poster boys who they bring to put a Dalit face on their campaign. But the folks behind it are not Dalits. And I think most Indians don't know this. So I figured somebody should bring that out. And I started following the money trail of some organizations to see where the money ends up in India and what they do with it. So for instance, in Texas, there is a Gospel for Asia. And they, on their net TV and YouTube, you know, they proudly denounce Hinduism as satanic and, you know, evil and pagan and all that. And they raise like $35 million a year, which goes mostly to South India, just for a year. It was one organization. So I kept compiling information, and I found that a lot of legal lobbying against India and against Hinduism was being done by the Lutheran Church. You know, we haven't done enough Purv Paksh on the West to look at one denomination at a time. You have to. Each one is distinct. And Lutheran Church, not in the US, but in Northern Europe, Germany, Finland, these countries, somehow they picked up this project that they should convince the United Nations and US Congress and European Union Parliament and UK, etc., to classify Dalits as a race, and therefore any bias against them would be considered racial bias, and they would be, it would be subject to UN laws on racism, and therefore subject to sanctions, that sort of thing. So this would be very dangerous for India, actually. So I've been looking at their conferences. They had meetings in various parts of the world. They had one in the Southeast Asia on Afro-Dalits, this sort of thing, racism, you know? And you know, often when I've gone and monitored what's going on, either in person or through somebody, I find there's no other Indian there, no other person from the dharmic civilizations there, not even concerned about monitoring. We're not even listening enough to other, what's going on. We're just busy in our own little group, having meetings and feeling very happy that I went at this meeting, you know. But these, it's very difficult to take our people out of the cocoon of comfort and go and attend these things. It's a lot of work to do that. Very difficult to get our people interested in what others are. But Lutherans is an interesting case that people should follow up. Then I found that the US Commission on Religious Freedom, which was set up by Clinton, an act of Congress, it was under the pressure of Pat Robertson and the Republican right wing. They wanted to have a law which would open up the floodgates for conversion in foreign countries. And they always like to use nice language, so they called it religious freedom, which means conversion, evangelizing. That's what religious freedom means. And so when Clinton was a bit, you know, on the back foot, so to speak, in terms of the support he needed for his bills and for his own political stuff, he had to concede a few things to them. So he signed this to keep the right wing happy in Congress in exchange for things that they did for him. So this became law. And the commission was set up with not a single Hindu. All the commissioners, most of them are radical right-wing Christians. Even today, there's not a single Hindu, Buddhist, Jain, Sikh on it. There was one Hindu who lasted a couple of years and got frustrated, couldn't get anything done, and quit. So one of the chapters in this Breaking India is a study of U.S. Commission on Religious Freedom. I think it's the first time anyone has done a print, published a whole report on what the commission has done vis-a-vis India. I've taken every single year and analyzed their position on India and its human rights and done an evaluation of whether it's biased or not biased and given actual facts to counteract what they're doing. And that by itself is a very practical project that if people want to take forward, you can take that chapter and give it to congressmen or give it to whoever you want to raise the issue with. But certainly the U.S. Commission on Religious Freedom has not proven to be neutral. The type of cases they select, the type of witnesses are brought in, the type of conclusions they reach and condemnations they reach, you'll never find that Christians have done anything wrong. I mean, the religious freedom is always like Hindus are a bunch of people with problems, and Muslims and so on. And the charter itself is biased. The charter is that they'll monitor cases of religious freedom violation in the whole world except the United States. That's the charter. So it's, we are exempt from being monitored here. You can't bring one because it doesn't fit the charter. So, and then the other interesting thing I found is that every year when the US does its human rights report, and India is now on the watch list of countries that are flagged as violators. And other countries are not a good bunch to be in the company of, like Yemen and North Korea and Cuba and Saudi Arabia and these kind of countries. So India is in that bracket. Now, as an Indian and somebody born and raised there, I mean, I find a lot of problems in India, a lot of things that upset me, but I don't think lack of religious freedom is a problem of India. I don't think that India lacks religious freedom, per se. I mean, India is one of the most free countries in terms of people having religious freedom. So it just seemed like completely out of line, and they just pick a few instances here and there. And I found that there is a news gathering, Christian news gathering machinery globally that feeds data, feeds episodes, feeds information, and then circulates it and makes it legitimate, so people believe in it. But when you start looking at some example they're citing, you start tracking it back. It's cited from some Christian source in India, not some independent source. It's never something that a court of law has ruled to be the truth, and no independent account has verified it. But just because one of the reporters there has put out this report and it sounds sensational, they're accusing that something happened where Christians were persecuted, this makes headlines, and these guys, this network circulates such things until it becomes established fact, and then all kinds of mainstream media start quoting them. Dalit Freedom gets into the act, many others get into the act, US Commission has hearings, brings these people to talk, they issue a report. So all this legitimizes what started out as a biased report in the first place. And I even saw in AAR, there was a meeting once many years ago, and I remember Diana Eck from Harvard, who's a prominent pluralism person, was involved in introducing the speakers, and the whole highlight, the spotlight was on this episode that Hindus had raped four Christian nuns in India. So this was a huge, everybody giving all these reports. Then it turned out that a few months later, the courts dismissed that charge. It turned out that the rapes had been done from people within the church itself. It was not any Hindus. So I wrote a letter to them saying that you should now next year have a panel to retract that. And you bring the other side of the story, let them, but of course they wouldn't do that. So they never bothered to respond to this. So one-sided things get in, and a certain smear campaign is created. When it is found to be false, they don't have the objectivity which scholars are supposed to have to actually make a corrective with equal force. That doesn't happen.